Good morning. Thank you, my friends here at Trinity, for coming out today. Thank you, Dr. Dockery, for that introduction. It is my honor and pleasure to stand before you this morning to have this discussion in this Oikonomia lecture series. This is entitled Love and Fairness, How Christians Can Approach Human Flourishing. Let me say at the outset that this is not a sermon. Now, I say this because I used to teach at a seminary, and I remember, right, what homiletics courses and exegetical courses do for church. You remember when you used to go to church and just sit and listen? You remember those days, right? Now you go as an analyst, right? Like, oh, no, wait, that was an aorist infinitive. What are you doing? I remember. So this is not a sermon. So if you're expecting something expository, I just want to invite you to sort of suspend that for just a moment, because I want to raise and offer up some principles I think that can help us as Christians think more broadly about this issue of human flourishing that originates from Jesus' central teaching here in Matthew on love. In particular, an opportunity and an invitation for us to love our neighbor as we love ourselves there in Matthew 22, verses 36 to 40. So that's what I'd like to offer up today for our consideration. On August 9th, Officer Darren Wilson killed an unarmed 18-year-old man by the name of Michael Brown in Ferguson, Missouri. Ferguson, Missouri, as many of you may know by now, is an older suburb of St. Louis. And in the weeks that followed the event, I was repeatedly asked to comment on the story, but I refused. I refused in part because a disaster that complex was something I didn't feel comfortable writing about without knowing as many details as possible. And this is one reason I still really haven't commented on that tragedy. As the various stories and competing narratives unfold, I still remain silent to this day on the details of that situation. However, I was extremely interested and in some cases saddened and in other cases completely nauseated by the response that I heard reading various blogs and Twitter feeds and Facebook news feeds on the internet by evangelical leaders and by pastors. And what I typically found is that people who had affinities with more progressive politics just sounded like progressives. And those who had more affinities toward conservative politics just sounded like conservatives. And what I discovered is that there was very little that was distinctly Christian. I'm sorry, I'm not preaching. There wasn't really much that was distinctly Christian. Distinctly Christian about people's responses. And what I mean by distinctly Christian is that for most evangelicals to this day, whether you are more progressive or more conservative, what I'm tending to find, and I'm not the only person who's noticed this, is that often we tend to approach the scriptures through a political ideology. And we'll often charge the other people with doing that, but not us. And it's often the political ideology that determines the ways in which we make application to the text that we exegete. So this is what I typically find in terms of how evangelicals go about the business of social ethics. And in particular, what I notice is that the pattern that I saw as I read the various comments about the tragedy in Ferguson, Missouri. So here's the first step. There are five steps to this. Here's the first step. For a variety of well-intentioned reasons, what evangelicals tend to do, no matter what political tribe you embrace, we choose some political ideology that we believe is the right one. The one that we believe will adequately address the differentiated problems in society. As David Koizus explains in the book Political Visions and Illusions, it could be libertarianism, or socialism, or nationalism, or conservatism, or progressivism, or some idea of direct democracy. Whatever that ism is, whatever that political ideology is, we embrace it. It often comes from our communities of discourse, the communities from which we were raised. That's usually step one. Now, what David Koizus does in the book, which I highly recommend, is he explains exactly how each one of these political ideologies are always idolatrous because ideologies always tend toward idolatry because politics can never do what God intends for the kingdom to do. It's impossible. But yet we run to politics as if politics is going to answer all the questions and fill in the blanks. It is literally impossible for that to happen because they all tend toward idolatry. So set one, you find some political ideology that you embrace. Step two, you read your preferred political ideology into the Bible in such a way that it becomes a tool for interpreting and applying the Bible to social issues. That is, your political ideology becomes your hermeneutic for a biblical view of justice. Step two. Step three, you then cherry pick Bible verses, usually taken out of context, and repackage them in such a way that your preferred tribal political ideology is not only biblical, it now follows the teachings of Jesus and is now Christian. Here the goal is to prove that God is obviously on your tribe's side. Step four, and now that you have baptized your political ideology and saturated it with random verses from the Bible, you're now ready to declare that your ideological tribe and those who agree with you are right. Now you are free to, in many cases, arbitrarily and randomly insert the phrase, "the gospel says," as the slam dunk defense of your now baptized political ideology. And as a result, any other tribe that does not read the Bible through your ideological lens is not only wrong, they are the enemy. They are a threat to the church and the world because now it's a gospel issue. Step five. Issue a call for all other Christians to embrace your tribal ideology because of the gospel. Now, your tribe is right, and you are free in the blogosphere and in social media, for example, to declare all of those who are not like us, those who are not in our tribe, to be wrong. Those in the other tribe, the enemy tribe, need to change their views so that they can more closely adhere to what our tribe believes about the Bible and therefore advance the right side of truth, your tribe's truth. If you believe a gospel, then you think like we do. Now, this is the essence of what I call evangelical tribalism because it is saturated in this rhetoric about the gospel. And so now the gospel becomes a weapon to be used to declare one tribe superiority to all the other expressions and understandings of what God could be possibly doing. So I don't know about you, but I am tired of the tribalism. I am worn out of the wars between Christians who are simply doing nothing more than seeking to defend some political ideology using God's word that was never written or intended to address or defend a political ideology. I am worn out. I'm done. So Christians, God's people, particularly in the West and more directly in America, I am proposing, need to do something different. Something better. Something that actually connects to the ways in which God's people have been thinking about human flourishing for 2,000 years that actually transcend and predate and supersede out of these all of these ideologies. What we've done now is simply demonize people with whom we disagree. Jonathan Haidt has this great book I recommend, The Righteous Mind, Why Good People Are Divided on Politics and Religion. And what he does is simply lays out the context, I think, often where we find the difference, the disparity that causes us to consider the other group the enemy that needs to be saved, that needs to be fixed, that needs to be rescued from their wrong thinking. So this is what it looks like in terms of thinking about how we construct an understanding of fairness. And then I want to propose 8 ways I believe Christians, God's people, can move forward and not get caught up in the idolatry of political ideologies. That's what Haidt observes. That conservatives, for example, view fairness, that is, how we should treat people fairly, in terms of whether or not people are free to be able to take advantage of the same processes available to them in society. While progressives tend to define fairness in terms of equality of material outcome and equality of proportion. Conservatives then are more concerned about whether all citizens are free to exercise their gifts and talents under the law to meet their own needs through participation in free markets. Progressives, on the other hand, conceptualize fairness as whether people have similar incomes or whether people have the same luxuries and opportunities in life. They envision a world where the force of government intervention eliminates certain disparities. So what a few of us are proposing is that we actually move beyond these sorts of binaries and actually begin to talk about the kinds of things that Christians have been talking about for 2,000 years, but we've been blocked off from that conversation because we've been too tied up in politics and political ideology. We're proposing that we think about what it means to care about people first and foremost because we love them. Now, listen, this is an old but yet a very new thing for us to think about. I mean, how many politicians do you hear talk about their love and affection for people? Now, it says here in the text, and again, I'm not preaching, but it says here in the text that the greatest commandment, the summary of all that points to the work and person of Christ and the mission of the kingdom is love, loving God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second is like it, right? To love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these 2 commandments, which are codified and saturated with love. And so I wonder what it's like for us to think about some different principles, some different ways to think about human flourishing that are not about whether or not your political ideology wins some stupid culture war, but being first and foremost concerned about the very people who are made in the image of God because you want to love them well. So here are eight principles that I'm proposing as a way to move forward that don't get us locked into this ideological battle between binaries. The first principle, of course, is love. I mean, think about this, right? The primary operating praxis and character of the kingdom is of the kingdom of God is actually love. Love is not about cultural conquest. Love is not about being right or hashtag winning, right? Or exclusion or political agendas. Love cares to help people understand who they are in relationship to God, his reign and his rule over all of the creation. Love for God is oriented around this uncompromising fidelity to love the things that God loves and to be loved as God intends for us to be loved and to love oneself, to understand one's humanity that is saturated by a holiness that is grounded in grace. To properly love one's neighbor predisposes a commitment to seek the good of the other because you care about the other's flourishing. A good that is characterized by God's revelation of what it means to truly love another person who bears the image of God. And so as you think about not just preaching and teaching and writing and being right theologically, but as you think about your future ministry context, in what ways do you want them to be saturated and characterized by places where people know and experience and feel that they are loved? That they should walk in your church possibly feeling unloved because of the craziness that is life, and they experience community with you and the members of your church and the members of your family, and they walk out and they say, this place is strange because I've never been loved this way before. I mean, could you imagine what your experience at Trinity would be like, that when you walk across the stage at commencement, you are in tears, not simply because of the great education that you receive, but because you experience love in this community in ways that you never have before. And that you were so captivated and changed by the love that you experience here that now you are on fire to love other people in the way that you've been loved right here. And you want your churches to be places of love, and your counseling offices to be places of love, and your Christian schools to be places of love, and all of your mission work to be places where people feel loved. It's not about these isms and ideologies and things with multiple syllables. One syllable, love. So what happens is that when we love people then, we have a different affection for their care, for their future. So we begin with love, and then secondly, we embrace the idea, the notion, as we've seen in the Christian tradition for 2,000 years, that humans have dignity. That because humans are made in the image and likeness of a triune God, they have an existential and ontological dignity that transcends them. It's not simply that humans bear the image and likeness of God, but they actually are the image and likeness of God. Herman Bavinck, one of my favorite dead theologians. I like the dead ones. Was quick to point out that this doctrine implies two things. One, that Christ was made human in our likeness. We see in Romans 3 and Philippians 2 and Hebrews chapter 8. And that Christians, having been conformed to the image of Christ, now are becoming like God. And then secondly, that the image extends to the whole person, soul and body, in all of his or her faculties and powers and in conditions and relations. Being truly human is what it means then to image God. And so loving others properly means wanting the image of God in others as whole people. Not just as minds, not just as souls, not just as hungry people or hurting people or rich people or poor people or brown people or whatever kind of people group you love. Not just those people, but whole people. And so because we love people, we want their minds to be what God wants their minds to be. We want their souls to be what God wants their souls to be. And we want them to experience the creation in the way that God designed them to experience the whole creation. So we don't bifurcate. We don't compartmentalize. We gather the resources of God's people to orient those in a place where they can flourish and engage all the aspects of being a whole person. And so this is the beauty, right? This is the beauty of a local church. I mean, imagine, this is crazy, right? Check this out. Right? So you have a church, which is this assembly of God's people who find themselves in all different aspects of culture. You got doctors and lawyers and janitors and plumbers and moms and second grade teachers and postal workers. You have this community of people who are in all these various spaces. And then you have this community in all these various spaces where they're actually being rallied around this message of God's redeeming all things through the working person of Christ, and they're submitting their lives to Jesus Christ. And then you bring other people whose minds and their souls and their bodies have been attacked by the enemy. And they come into a community of people who've experienced all sorts of holistic healing of their mind and body and souls. And now they have opportunity to actually love people well from all of those spaces. How beautiful is this? That the church provides the context by which people, whole people, cannot just be preached at in their heads. Not just fed stuff. Because they're hungry. Not just hugged, but all of those things. That's the beauty of the church. I mean, this is the beauty of God's kingdom, is that people get to be brought into all of those things. I mean, this is absolutely wonderful. So when you see a human person, it's a man or a woman who has dignity and now an opportunity to be loved properly. This is what we care about them, all of them, their mind and their body and their soul. So we do this, of course, with other Christians, with other people. So I mentioned the church because there is this sense, this third point here, that we are people who engage these things in solidarity with others. Not just your local church or your local denomination or your national denomination, but you do this in solidarity with all of God's people because we're all in this together. So we look for ways to partner and be in union with the rest of God's people to reach people because we love them, because they have dignity, So we look for ways to lock arms with the various aspects of God's kingdom locally and nationally and internationally, because there is no them and us. There's just us. There's just the we. So it means then that we ask different kinds of questions because we love people, because they have dignity, because we're in this together. We now can ask different kinds of questions. And so one of my favorite theologians /politician/pastor/, Abraham Kuyper, introduces this principle of sphere sovereignty. Because what it does, it recognizes the importance of the person, recognizes the opportunity for dignity to flourish. It recognizes that Christians have a role to play in forming people's minds and bodies and souls and setting them free to do what God intends for them to do in whatever spaces in which they are. So Kuyper says this: if the family, business, science, art, and so forth are all social spheres which do not owe their existence to the state, and which do not derive the law of their life from the superiority of the state, but obey a higher authority within their own bosom, an authority which rules by the grace of God, just as the sovereignty of the state does. In other words, it's a violation of human solidarity and human dignity for higher orders of society to undermine and violate the functions of lower orders, as well as the spheres to extend beyond their expertise and competence and design into other spheres. So Christians then are concerned, fourthly, about flourishing social spaces, social spheres, because we want God's people and all people, right? We want people to be in those spaces to do what God has designed those spaces to do for the right reasons. And so we love people well enough. We love them with dignity. We lock arms with people to see that, fourthly, they're in those social spaces to do what God intends to do through them and in them, in those spaces. Again, this is the beauty of the church, because you have opportunity if you're going to be a church leader, a pastor, a teacher, a counselor, Sunday school teacher, a parent even. You have opportunities to actually form the people who are going to be sent into these spaces for the glory of God and for the good of other people. It's this a beautiful institution, the church. So then, because of this, we ask different questions. And these questions I'm going to raise here are oriented around these earlier principles. If it's true that we love people and they have dignity and that we're all in this together and that we care about the flourishing of all the cultural spaces that God has created in the creation for His glory and our good, then we're asking different kinds of questions then about what people deserve. That's the fifth point. What do people deserve? If they have dignity, if we love them, then how do we think about what they deserve? And then who determines the answer to that question? So if we love people and seek their good, what people deserve are opportunities to live out their vocations as human beings, having freedom to do things that humans were created and designed to do. This includes freedom from people making too many decisions for them, for the development of their moral virtue, and also freedom to lose oneself in the good, to lose oneself in the common good. So what do people deserve? I mean, we often don't even ask the question. We just make assumptions about what people deserve on the basis of the most recent preferred ideology. The next question is this: how do we create a culture of reciprocity? That's number six. How do we reciprocate this? David Smith, who teaches at the University of Arizona, calls this transitive reciprocity. He says that when people reciprocate, they teach people around them to cooperate. In the process, they not only respect justice, but they also foster it. Specifically, he argues, they foster a form of justice that enables people to live together in mutually respectful peace. So it's interesting, right? The political economists talk about transitive reciprocity, but in the biblical narrative, it's simply do unto others as you would have them do unto you. So how do we create opportunities and context where our people actually want to be gracious to others because they've been the recipients of grace? So we love our neighbors because we've been so loved by God. We pass it on. You may have heard the phrase, pay it forward. So what we want are our context where people are so enthralled and so impacted by grace that they want to be gracious to other people. They want to love people well, which includes it sometimes not just dumping a bucket of ice on your head for a Vine video, but actually stepping into the brokenness of someone's messy life, someone's difficult health issue, someone's poverty, for the sake of being a blessing to them because you have been such a recipient of God's blessing. You've been blessed not simply by the gospel itself, but you've been blessed by the church. You've been blessed by community. You've been blessed by relationships. And so you want to, because you receive these things, you want to pass this on to others. I know this sounds kind of like hippie-ish, right? Love, man. Like, I've been loved. I've been hugged. I'm going to go hug you. It's like a hug chain. But this is what reciprocity is all about. How do we create and foster the sorts of context where people reciprocate? And I'm going to argue that the church is the place where we hone the skill of reciprocity. And then we show the world, we show our neighbors, we show our cities, we show our states, we show them what it looks like to be communities of people who sacrifice their own personal time, talents, and treasures for the sake of the flourishing of the other. The seventh point, which is another question we ask, is simply, what does equality mean? We throw the word around about being equal, equal this, and equal rights, but what does equality actually mean? And how has the Christian tradition thought about the issue of equality? Do we want a society that understands and considers equality on the basis of human dignity, or do we want to think about equality on the basis of political ideology? And lastly here, the question, this eighth point, is what do people really need? If we believe that people are to be loved well, and we believe that they have dignity, if we believe that they have a transcendent, eternal destiny, what do people really need for their minds and their souls and their bodies? And then as we unpack that question, we begin to see that perhaps all of the political ideologies that we so love are not properly structured to answer this question. So my invitation to you is to be a community of people who actually have the freedom to suspend your ideological preferences for the sake of answering these kinds of questions. To be mindful and cognizant of the fact that God's people have been orientated around loving God and loving neighbor. And so when we look at a human person, when you see a child, when you see an elderly person, when you see someone who is suffering or someone who is living well, what do they need? And then how can I in my person, or how can we as a church, or how can we as God's people facilitate what God intends for people according to his design for them and the world? I am so excited because I believe that I am not alone in being done with it and being ready to move on the basis of how the Christian tradition has addressed these issues, because the world needs to see a community of people who go about these things differently. And I believe that through the Church of Jesus Christ, that God is raising up a cadre of men and women who are ready to do this differently for the glory of God and for the good of people. Thank you very much for your time.